where am I at? Let's just, where am I at on time? How long have I been going?
47.
Okay. I'll give you, if there's something that's really on your mind, definitely throw your hand up and ask me. But I'll have a Q&A there. And is there anything right now?
Actually, I had a bunch of questions as you talked them.
All right, well, fire me out one now as we're taking a break.
Are we breaking?
Well, we're kind of taking a break. If you got to use the restroom, use it now, you know.
All right.
I need a break because I... Okay. Okay. That basically, I just went through the introduction, and I'm going to get into, I want you to clear your head a little bit, okay? Because I'm going to get into some of the more important things of what I think that now. Tracy just walked in here. She would be co-founder, co-owner. I spoke a little bit about the relationship as far as working together with the spouse. She can probably talk more about that than I can. Basically, the way that we've worked it out, if you're in the situation or you find yourself in the situation, our roles in our department are as far apart as can possibly be. Okay, I do nothing in the office downtown. I don't even know really which button to press to hang the phone up and which one to put it on hold. Okay, I don't know how to use the intercom. I don't deal with that. Okay, she's the office manager. She deals with all the office staff that's over there. I go in and I kind of look around and watch. See, you know, I look for communication. I look for roadblocks. I ask questions. Usually I get told to shut up. I have no idea what I'm talking about. And then I'm out of there. You know, my role is I work with the technical people of the website as far as what you see on the website. I work with the contractors. And I throw the ideas out to have tested. And the other thing that my role is anything new that I don't know how it's going to work, I take it upon myself to try. For example, YouTube would be an example there. You know, YouTube came out. We thought, well, let's see if this can actually be used as a social media to try to help us. All right, well, who's going to take the time to film these things? Who's going to edit them? Who's going to upload them? Do I want to go hire somebody to do this when I don't even know if there's a return? No. I would rather just do it myself, you know, because I have the free time in my schedule to be able to experiment with those things and see what the return is. If the return is positive, well, then yes, I will delegate it and find somebody else to do it. And if need be, I will hire somebody else to do it. So with the social media right now, that's something I'm really behind. I'm pushing hard and I'm doing a lot of the social media stuff to see if there's a return on that. YouTube, there really was no return. The only return is they host the video, which saves us a whole lot of money. But we send them more traffic than they send us. Okay, so as far as that, that's why you don't see videos being posted as frequently as they used to be. Business-wise, it's a waste of time, okay? But it does host the video. So I still put them up there enough to satisfy the people that like to watch the videos. But that's it. There's no sense in going more than that just because I think it's cool. You know, it's a waste of my time that needs to be devoted into other mechanisms. You know, to where now I'm all about Twitter, Facebook, all this different stuff, trying to see where my ROI is going to be and what that ROI is. ROI is return on investment. I will determine what that ROI is. And when it gets to a point to where we could actually hire somebody as a contractor part-time to do it for us, then I will do that. But keep in mind, we're going to get a percent of that ROI. It's not like as soon as this has a return on an investment equal to $1,000, I'm going to hire somebody for $1,000. No, I'm going to hire them for $200. You know, so we have that. But still, then I will move on to whatever the next thing is that needs to be tested to try to help drive the business. So I move around. That would be what my role is. Whereas I said, Tracy's role is the staff. All right. And anytime we've crossed roles, there's been problems. So we've kind of learned we try to stay out of each other's business. Now, it doesn't always work. Okay. And you got to try to somehow or another learn how to separate, you know, business from your personal life. But as a couple, when you're both in the same business, it sometimes the only time you have to discuss business is going to be at home. You know, so a lot of the advice that, you know, people will put out there, leave it in the office and all this, it's all bullshit. All right, it doesn't work that way. You know, it's just when there's issues, you know, you deal with them, try to get them over with. But it's definitely not easy, and it takes work. Business takes work, relationships take work. So, you know, I've already talked about work enough so people understand that. Passion, I feel, is the most important component of entrepreneurship or any business. I think you have to have passion for what you do. You have to have a desire for what you're doing that's so strong that nothing's going to stop you. All right. And by that, I spoke earlier, you know, about the PRs and, you know, helping people get better. And, you know, all that training's been a part of my life for so long, I can't define it without it. You know, yes, there's family and all the other things. There's other roles. I don't want to get that confused. They're separate. But training has been a part of me since I was 13 years old. All right. It was a part of me that came into my life at a time where I thought I was worthless. You know, I've wrote in the Under the Bar book before about learning disabilities and my background in school and all this other kind of stuff. I was not a premier student. You know, every learning disability you can think of, I was labeled with, from dyslexia, learning disability. I'd have to think of the list. You know, you name it, I was there. You know, I was the guy that had the little desk that had a little clock on it with the little arrows that would say like 1 o'clock, and that's when I had to go to my special ed, you know, to go see my tutor there. And this is all through grade school, you know, getting beat up, you know, anything. Think back to the special ed kids when you were growing up. You know, it's different now, but back then I was that kid. You know, I was a kid in the presidential physical fitness exam. I couldn't do the pull-up, I couldn't run, I couldn't do this. I was the kid that got beat up every single time I go home. You know, I was a kid that didn't have friends in the neighborhood, that just spent most of my time hanging out, you know, sitting by a tree looking up at the clouds. You know, and I can go on and on and on and on and tell you all these stories, you know, like, all that sucks, and, you know, but it's all in how you define things and how it's defined for you. You know, in the book, Raising the Bar, which will be the second part of Under the Bar, you know, I write a story about when I was in sixth grade, coming home from school. You know, I'd walk through yards, and getting beat up was, like I said, pretty much a regular thing. Walking through yards, and there's a group of kids playing in the backyard. Remember the tetherball, that stupid game that you play with that thing? Well, they'll take the rope, and I was walking through the yard, and they whipped it at me, and the thing lassos around my feet, you know, whaps me down on the ground, and they just start beating the shit out of me. Meanwhile, the other kids that are walking, you know, are all stopping and laughing and all this kind of stuff. Meanwhile, I'm getting kicked and all this other kind of, you know, it's going on for 5 minutes. And they start dragging me around the yard. And I remember getting my face drugged through shit, you know, so they're dragging me through. And then pretty much everybody stops after they realize, you know, I'm not going to sit there. I'm not going to cry. I'm not going to scream. I'm not going to say shit. And I'm just going to sit there and I'm going to take it until they stop, because that's kind of what I learned to do. And when they finally left and I took the ropes up and I put on, you know, got on one knee, I got on the other knee, I stood up, it hit me. It doesn't matter what the fuck anybody ever does to me, I will always get back up, okay? That was the first lesson that I learned, that for years of my life, I would look back on that story and it would kill me. You know, it wasn't until just probably the last year where I realized one of the best things that ever happened to me. Because it was that day that I learned that it's not what happens in your past that determines what you do. It's how you interpret what happens in your past that determines what you do. That day I turned shit into gold. All right. That day I learned it doesn't matter what you want. You can always get back up again. All right. No matter how beat down you get or what happens. What was soon after that, actually that following Christmas, I got a weight set and I started training. And it gave me something to do, you know, other than sitting in a tree looking up at the clouds. Which, by the way, it's, as I said before, it's how you look back on things. You know, there's 13 means of learning. The school system teaches 7. Okay, so a lot of people that will be labeled learning disabled really are not. They're learning enabled in a different way. Okay, so while I sit there and say, you know, I spent all these hours looking at the clouds, you know, somebody asked me one time, what do you do when you're stuck? and you don't know what to do, and you got a business problem or whatever it is. I said, well, I get in my car and I drive.